Ever since coming back to YouTube, I've been getting a lot of welcoming comments. The hair. Oh wow, the hair. The voice hasn't changed a bit though. Nice quarantine haircut. I absolutely didn't recognize him with all that hair. Full on hippie now, I guess. No offense intended, but I have to say, since you've gone to Vietnam, you seem to have the hippie hairstyle going on. Damn, your face changed a lot. I think it's the hair. Back when I started this channel, I had a complex about relevance and making my videos in such a way that they could stay relevant. See, the problem with this is you never know what could happen. For example, if 3 years ago someone said to me, "Barry, I want to invest all my money into one product. I just don't know what that particular product should be." How awesome would it have been if I said face masks? See, how are you going to expect something like that? And what remains relevant is not up to me or the mighty power of my scripting to decide. How the hell am I supposed to know if even something like PC gaming entirely could become irrelevant or not? But as I look back in some of my old videos, I think it's time that I rejuvenate some of them. Starting with a setup tour, as I haven't done one of those since my last special. So, let's see what's changed. Let's start with my computer. Now I know there are going to be a few of you who are thinking, "Barry, why is your PC on the carpet?" Duh. Static electricity overclocks your PC for you. Now, yeah, honestly, it would be better to have this on a small table or even on my desk, but I live on the wild side because I'm a badass. Deal with it. Now, this case may look familiar to some of you. This is the GameDia's Talos P1, and it's a hell of a case. Now, yeah, she is completely a YouTuber case. "Hey guys, check out my amazing computer build!" But there's one feature that I fell in love with beyond the aesthetic, and that is the doors. These have mini-fridge style doors on both sides of the case, making it easy to get in there to unplug hard drives, manage some cables, and clean up the dust from the inside. There's a magnet on the glass that keeps it nice and tight, and I just love the practicality of this design. I will say though that cleaning the front fans is a pain in the ass, and as for moddability, this logo and this dock down here can be switched out for a fan controller, but because of how they set this up, it's a hassle to get everything in the front here removed just for a simple fan controller. Beyond that though, it's an excellent case. I always liked having a flashy computer. People who know gaming PCs will look at my desktop and go, "Whoa, awesome build, man," and then those who don't know anything about computers will still look at it and go, "Whoa," which is always a nice feeling. Inside her, starting with the motherboard, is the Asus Prime Z370 with an i7-8700K. I've also got 32GB of unnecessary RGB RAM running at 3200MHz. My CPU cooler is the GameDia's Kioni P1A360R, which sports three 120mm fans and of course some RGB that can be Aura controlled. My power supply is also GameDia's. This is the Cyclops X1 1200W power supply. It's 80 plus platinum, which is incredibly efficient, and it'd run anything that I ever needed for the rest of the time. I also have about 9TB of storage in here, a 1TB Micron SSD, a 3TB Western Digital hard drive for games, and a 5TB Seagate hard drive for cold storage. Lastly, my GPU. I'm still running the GTX 1080 Ti from a few years ago. The 20 series cards were a bit of a joke, so my plan was to wait out that generation and get a 30 series. However, with the big trip coming up, I won't be able to take this PC with me, and I figure I'll probably sell it and buy a 30 series gaming laptop with the money. Now, you guys know me. Gaming laptops are never my first choice, but with the space that I'd save and the power consumption being significantly less on a laptop, it'd just be more practical and it'd make more sense. If you don't know anything about my trip, go ahead and watch my "I bought a van" video to figure out what's going on there. Moving on to the next part of my build is my desk. This is the VanSpace ergonomic gaming desk, and even though it has an incredibly fitting name, I'm not going to be taking this in my van on the road trip. It's a very versatile desk though. Sits 28 inches tall by 55 inches long and 23 inches wide. It came with a full desk mat that I used for a while, but these desk mats catch a lot of cat hair, which is why I decided to remove it. The desk has a carbon fiber style, which is beautiful and sturdy. I really like the space and the practicality of these cable holes in the back. This leads down into the cable management basket that this desk is also equipped with, which was a huge plus. My cables have never looked so clean back here. Another couple options for this desk was the headphone mount here on the left side and a cup holder here on the right, which I opted out of both but are still awesome to include. This desk also came with a game/controller dock which had four USBs at the bottom. I love the idea, but it's made of some pretty cheap plastic that made the desk look a bit cluttered, and USBs didn't charge anything very fast, and even if I had them plugged in directly to the computer, a USB wouldn't actually open if you connected it. They're USB charging ports only, so I decided to remove the dock. As for my keyboard and mouse, I'm still using the Rockhat Kone XTD, and my next mouse will be Rockhat again. If you remember the story, I had my first Rockhat Kone for over 2 years and then it broke on me. Started double or triple clicking even though I'd only clicked once and the laser had also been malfunctioning at times. I sent Rockhat a message about this to see if they could have it fixed since it was well outside of its warranty and they just sent me a new one. That was awesome of them and it's almost time I upgrade anyway, so it'll be cool to see what Rockhat's been doing lately. As for my keyboard, this is easily the nicest keyboard that I've ever had. I always had a checklist when it came to keyboards. I want media buttons to control brightness, volume, pause, and play. I don't always use them, but I love to have them, and this keyboard has that. I also want macro keys that I can use to launch my favorite programs, and this also has 5 of them. I have G1 set to open Steam, G2 is Photoshop, G3 is Audacity, and so on. This keyboard also came with features that I never even realized I wanted. For example, it's Bluetooth, so I can pair it to multiple computers and use it around my house. I can also shut the keyboard off completely with this switch back here to save battery, or more realistically, when my goddamn cats jump up on my desk while I'm trying to watch a movie or write a script. Instead of them screwing everything up, I just flick the keyboard off and they can go nuts. It's just practical, and this is something that I definitely will be taking on my trip. Moving on, we have my monitors. The first one is the Acer CB280HK, which I've had since my first setup tour. This is my first 4K monitor, and it's still a great screen. The panel could be better. I do notice blacks are hard for this thing depending on the game or the movie I'm watching, but when you got a resolution like this, how can you really complain? My second monitor is my preferred gaming monitor though. This is Dell's 27-inch 144Hz G-Sync monitor, and she is pretty. Now for watching movies, this is not a fantastic panel. The colors are a bit off compared to my 4K Acer, but when it comes to playing video games, I just can't go back. 144fps is gorgeous, and it took me until after I quit my job at Falcon Northwest before I even got one of these things. Which is way too long to wait for a frame rate like this, but regardless, I love it. As far as G-Sync goes, I think it could be better. There have been flicker issues that I've had to fix, and other little V-Sync issues in games every so often, but beyond the mild hiccup, this thing's a beauty. Sometimes I just throw a folder back and forth between my 60Hz panel and this one just to play with the difference in frame rate. Now you may have noticed these bad boys sitting back here, and if you did, it probably means you might be an audiophile. These are the Klipsch R51PMs that I've been using as my desktop speakers, and let me tell you, these are clean. You can blast these puppies and the audio remains crisp. I got these while I was working at Best Buy, and they're probably one of the better purchases that I made while I was there. I honestly don't see myself needing new computer speakers ever again, and if I ever get myself a full home surround system, I can use these. What's great about these things too is they're Bluetooth compatible, so you can take them anywhere around your house and jam out. God, I love Klipsch, but let's keep going. Wait, what? You're using the Yeti again, Barry? And I decided to switch back to the Blue Yeti as it's easier to travel with than the Caddy 300S. Don't get me wrong, that Caddy made me sound amazing, but there are a few niceties about using a USB mic than an XLR. Sure, your voice is going to be much milkier on the XLR, but the echoes those mics pick up is very annoying to deal with. And I had a lot of extra audio editing that I had to do, whereas for the Yeti, I just speak into it and I'm good. I don't have to fill my room with soundproofing foam or get into Audacity and cut out background noise, and come on, I'm not hosting a radio show or making hardcore movie intros or anything like that. Fine, my voice won't be as sexy, but do I really need the help? Alright, enough narcissism, let's move on. The last few items are my peripherals. Last time I made a setup tour, I talked about the Afterglow controller, which is great, but they don't tend to last more than a couple years or so, depending on how aggressive that you are with them. My Xbox One Elite controller, on the other hand, is sturdy as hell. Comes with a crapload of extra switches and joystick options, and even a different D-pad. Now, this is the Xbox One Elite, so it needs the dongle to hook up to your PC, which is kind of annoying that I have to waste a USB that could be used for something else. The Series 2 Xbox Elite controllers will just Bluetooth, which is a lot nicer, and I'll probably upgrade to one of those eventually. Now, one little trick for these, get a refurbished one. These things go for $150 to $180, which is stupid money to pay for a controller. The refurbished ones are just as good as the new ones, and if it fails on you, the company you bought it from will send you another refurbished one. Maybe you're the kind of person who wants never been used, unopened box, but if I can save money here, I can put it into better specs for my PC. Shop smarter or be rich, my friends. This moves us over to my headset, which are the Sennheiser PC37X. Now I know that sounds like a strange name for Sennheiser headset, and that's because these are actually the Game 1s that have been renamed for a Mass Drop collaboration. These are open back headsets, which I love as I can hear everyone in the room around me and the game that I'm playing at the same time. They're also very lightweight and comfortable, and I never end up motion sick with these on as I have with other headsets I've worn. And I think it's that lightweight open back design that's what makes that miracle happen. I didn't mean to be such a wuss, I was born this way. I also still have the Logitech C920 webcam, which has been the standard streamer's webcam for years and has done me well. The last peripheral I have that I never expected to have is this desk lamp by BenQ. This thing is $100 and all it does is give off light when I need it. $100 for a USB light is way too much in my opinion, but it is pretty cool. It's designed so it won't cause any monitor glare when you turn it on. It also has a touch button for brightness and another for warmth. You can also have this thing turn on and off for a second each, which... why? And I know I'm being hard on this thing, it's honestly great, but I just gotta narc on BenQ here a bit for that price. It still amazes me. Now the last part of my setup is my chair, and I have two. I've been using the GameDia's Achilles M1 for a little over a year now, and I love it, but something hysterically ironic happened. One of the metal rings on one of the wheels of the chair broke. I glued it back together and I haven't used it since, but how funny is it that the Achilles gaming chair broke at the heel? You gotta be kidding me, right? So I've been using my weed chair from FowNow, and it's a lovely chair and makes all my friends laugh when they come over. Nice chair, Barry. The only thing I'll say about this chair is it's a bit backwards, and here's what I mean. You can sit down and rock in this chair anytime. It's not locked into any position like other chairs are. When you find a comfy position, you can lock it into place and it won't move from that spot, but as time goes on, I notice myself getting a bit fatigued while sitting in it, and it could be that whole system there. Otherwise, the built-in non-removable pillows could also be a factor, but again, how can you complain? It's a great chair, and it really accentuates the rest of my setup. Now this is the coolest part of my build. My computer is black. My desk is black. My monitors, speakers, controller, and headset, all black. I wanted for so long to be able to call my build pure black, and now I finally can. Son of a